Good evening and welcome to Christchurch. If you're here in church or you're watching via this YouTube stream, welcome to this memorial service. Just a note to those people who are here in church that you're invited to stay after the service as long as you wish, to linger. There won't be any music, it'll just be a quiet church. But if you'd like to spend some time in this church in prayer, then please feel that you can, that you don't have to rush away. When the service is over, I will go down that far aisle and just wait patiently at the end of church, at the back of church, just to greet you as you leave. We at Christchurch offer this memorial service on this day every year, partly because the longest night, the 21st of December, is symbolic of the struggle in grief. It also is an acknowledgement that for many people who have lost loved ones, Christmas is not easy. And so we hope and pray that you will find this service helpful in your loss. Of course, you need not have lost a loved one, someone dear, to suffer loss. All of us in coronavirus are suffering the grief of loss of a life that we have lost because of all the lockdown measures. And so again, we hope that what we offer tonight will be helpful in understanding what is going on in us as we come to terms with everything that has changed. I want to introduce this book that you will hear excerpts from tonight. It's called Postcards from the Land of Grief by Richard Littledale. We will be reading excerpts from this book. You'll hear them in a moment. Richard Littledale is a Baptist minister who lost his wife some years ago to cancer. And he diaried his journey through grief. He wrote as a series of postcards, and those postcards have been or are very insightful as to what he was going through, and in fact, what many people go through in grief and in loss. I found this book to be enormously helpful when I was given it some months ago. It helped me understand what I was going through in all the turmoil of coronavirus. And it had helped me understand some of the people I tried to help in my pastoral ministry with funerals. So tonight, we're going to hear six excerpts, six postcards from this book on the videos, and I'll come back and lead us in one more reflection from Richard Littledale's book. We'll sing a hymn, and then there'll be a blessing, and then an invitation again to stay and linger in this beautiful place. But let us hear some excerpts from Richard Littledale's book, Postcards from the Land of Grief.
I am learning that the landscape of grief is a strangely unnerving place. In part, its strangeness is that those things which you had thought would be familiar are not familiar at all. Grief can turn a soft memory into an unforgiving rock face, or a hairbrush into a sword to pierce the heart. Regrets, like injected foam, expand to fill the space you give them. Words spoken or heard are like an old cassette left next to a magnet, muffled by exposure to greater force. There is beauty here, but it is strange and unnerving. In the end, the only thing which can pass the border controls into this strange new land is the fate which was there before its gates opened. The one who was there on the other side is here on this side too, as it turns out. God, who created the love which hurts so much, will also give the balm to soothe the ruinous of grief. Not today, nor tomorrow perhaps, but in time. Early on Monday morning last week, before things began to crumble so dramatically and irreversibly, I took a walk in the frost. The most ordinary things, like a crumpled and discarded bud, were turned into delicate works of art by the icy fingers of winter. I shall continue to look for beauty in this new winter landscape, and I believe I shall find it.
As I continue to live in this new land of grief, I am struck by the parallels with other times when I have stayed away from home. At first, you can be so taken with the novelty of what you see around you that the country you have left behind seems shabby or dull or uninteresting by comparison. Stay a little longer and some of the quirks of what you have left behind assume a kind of rosy glow, making you curious to sample them once again. Stay longer still, and the limitations of the new place may become rather more annoying than the ones you have left behind. In short, it is time to go back. The comparison is not always fair, since the travels I describe above have always been ones I have chosen to undertake. Not so on this occasion. Furthermore, going back is not an option. I cannot go back to where I used to live. My ticket was one way. That is not to say that I am stuck here, though. There is a path, but it lies ahead rather than behind. I've not been here long enough to discern it yet, but I know that it is over there, in another place. Yesterday, I paid a visit to Anthony Gormley's artwork of the same name, a place I had last visited with Fiona. The statues will still stand there, stock still and staring out to sea. Sometimes they are hidden, sometimes they stand tall, but always they turn their gaze to another place. I was especially struck by one figure. The waves were lapping at his chest and all but engulfing him. He is unmoved and he continues to look to another place. I'm hoping I can do the same.
Sometimes, when living in a strange land, you find yourself drawn to others who also never expected to be here. Like you, they are out of context and looking for anchors in an alien place. 10 days ago, I met such a stranger. Ginny was born in Ireland in 2016 and for some reason found herself without a home. Rounded up and brought across to a small village in West Berkshire, she came into the tender care of the Dogs Trust. It was there that she and I met each other. As a lurcher, she doesn't really have a voice, but her silence spoke to mine. Looking for another breed entirely, I found myself drawn so powerfully to her. Maybe there was a sadness or a wisdom reflected in those amber eyes. Or maybe I just fell for the tasseled ears. Either way, I was smitten. After careful checks by the Dogs Trust and some trial walks, she has now come to live here with me. These two characters, thrust out of context by circumstances they did not choose, are pooling their resources to forge a new context. She is a little nervous, and I have a lot to learn. But the partnership has so much to offer.
I once heard a refugee describe how the border with his home country ran just alongside his refugee camp. He could stand at the edge of the camp and gaze across at an old familiar tree in the home country, but he could not go there. The border was both invisible and impervious. I'm finding that the landscape of grief has just such a border. I can gaze across it at old familiar things. I can watch normal life unfold before my eyes, and I can stand and have conversation with those across the border, as if nothing separated us. That said, it is impossible to cross for now. When it comes down to it, they live there and I live here, and nothing can be done about that. I make occasional forays into their land, and they are precious. It turns out, though, that I take the border with me. I am like a cartoon character racing to outrun an elastic band, legs rearing and arms pumping. But the snap of the elastic must bring me back as surely as night follows day. The refugee made a new life for himself across the border. He would still gaze from time to time at the old familiar tree, but he found others in his new home. Like the old one, they provided shade and the kind of mental landmark which makes any new place a little less strange. Today, I shall go looking for trees.
Yesterday was a good day, infused with zesty scent of new possibilities and a whole string of new stories to be published. Yesterday was a bad day, stalked by the dank smell of melancholy. Yesterday was a good day, meeting with people who matter in all sorts of ways. Yesterday was a bad day, with fears about tomorrow, playing some ghastly version of hide and seek amongst the realities of today. Yesterday, like most days in this foreign land, was exhausting. It's easy to forget that simply living abroad in a place where language and culture and norms do not come naturally is tiring. Unwittingly, you are engaged in a constant battle to adjust, as if spending your day on a balance ball. Years ago now, I spent a year living abroad and speaking a foreign language nearly all the time. For the first few months, even the very business of living was exhausting. The years have not changed that. Hopefully, the intervening years have taught me that fatigue cannot be ignored like some distant smoke alarm, which seems like somebody else's problem. Instead, it must be accommodated, like a creeper growing round the lamppost or a tree growing away from the immovable fence. This too is an adjustment. But hopefully it will pay dividends when said tree flourishes.
If you're going to stay in a foreign land, then the chances are that before too long you will have to work. The time will come when you have to swap just arrived or settling in status for one of us. And you may have leave to remain stamped in your passport. Today, that day has come for me. Accompanied by my new companion, I shall head into work and see whether the mantle of Baptist minister still fits about my shoulders. Around me, I have an invisible army of people praying for me. Before me, I have a crowd of lovely people who are ready to welcome me. And within me, I have something else. A calling. Some 26 years ago, on the day that I was ordained, the preacher picked up on an obscure text from the Old Testament. It was the story of Gideon. Gideon was an unlikely hero who found himself thrust into the limelight to lead a small army to a great victory. The text said the following. The Spirit of the Lord clothed Gideon, and he sounded the trumpet. God had a tune to be played, and a trumpet on which to play it. But the missing piece was a man like Gideon, fearful, unsure and unsteady, but with enough puff to do the job. In truth, I do not know until I try whether I have enough puff to do the job. But today, I pick up the trumpet.
This is postcard number 23, and it's entitled, A Song Far From Home. To live in this foreign land and yet still try to sing a song of faith is not a new thing. People of faith were doing it as far back as the 6th century BC, when exiles on the bank of the river Tigris tried to remember their spiritual home, even though it cost them dear. In Psalm 137, harps hung on a tree and captors smirking at them, they tried to summon up a faith all but quashed by their circumstances. Today, before a congregation of Christians drawn from every tradition in Newbury, I sought to do the same thing. And Richard Littledale addresses the congregation thus. As most of you know, my wife Fiona died in November last year. For the past 7 years, she has been battling cancer with multiple surgeries and repeated rounds of chemotherapy. On at least 2 occasions during that time, bad news was delivered at Easter. On both occasions, it was a Maundy Thursday. Last year was no exception. On Maundy Thursday, her oncologist finally told us that there was no more which could be done. All curative options had been exhausted. Fiona was handed over to the care of the local Sue Ryder palliative care team, who would see her through to the end. The next day was Good Friday, and we were both here, along with all of you. After the service, we joined in the walk through the town to the Methodist Church. When we got there, Fiona had to sit on the wall for the short service in the open air, as she was too weak to stand. This was to be an Easter like no other, and our last together. 2 days later, I left the house shortly before 7 for the Easter sunrise service. Fiona was really needing her sleep at the time, so I closed the front door very quietly behind me. That is when it struck me with a kind of searing clarity. Next year, she will be up before I am at Easter. There it is. In all its simplicity and depth, what we sing about, what we proclaim in our churches, all comes down to this. Do we believe that those who die in Christ are raised to life? I do. And it makes it possible to live in a miasma of constant sadness, but with an unshakable hope. I shall celebrate this Easter without her, but not without hope. And on Sunday morning, she will be up before I am. Let us pray. Ever-loving Father, we pray that you will be patient with us in our wanderings, in our confusion, in our anger, in our impatience, in our despair, and in our asking. We ask you, Lord, to be patient with us. We ask, O Lord, is there a hope? Is it true that on Christmas you gave your Son, and on Easter he died so that we might live and live forever? Is it true that I will meet those whom I dearly miss? I will meet them again. Is it true? Father God, shine a ray of hope in our darkness. And we pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. You need not stand for this hymn. You need not even sing, but may it be a comfort to you. Abide with me.
Tears.
we've come to the end of this service. Again, if you're here in church, you need not rush off. You may want to linger here in front of the cross and the manger scene. You may want to once again commend your loved ones to Christ. But go with this blessing. May the peace of God be always with you. May the assurance of salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord be always with you. And may the comfort of the Holy Spirit be always with you. And may the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest and abide with you and with me this day and forevermore. Amen.